gawain at sa CIAN, Center for Youth Advocacy and Networking, na patuloy na nagpupursige sa gitna ng marami mga pagsubok. Nakakatuwa at nakakataba ng puso na ang sanggunian, si Luigi, at si ang COA, si Yesu, ay nagpaunlak ng initiative na ito na matagal nang andyan. No? Sabi nga ni Marlon, 4 na taon nang umiikot ang exhibition na ito. At minsan na tumaan dito. Liban dito actually, pati sa Rockwell campus. In fact, the last time I saw this exhibit was at Rockwell, a little less than a year ago. As you can see, the exhibition is a series of panels, 20 panels counting the title panel, that in a very well-prepared, well-researched manner presents the truth about what happened during martial law. And the Commission on Human Rights is really very encouraged by this initiative, and we would like to continue to manifest support to this exhibition entitled For Democracy and Human Rights. We know that this information needs to get to more people, and we are currently looking for ways to help Marlon. Marlon approached us and asked if we could help reproduce. So we're looking for ways to reproduce them. As you can see, these panels have been taken well care of, but they seem to be fading a little bit. So we really need to create a new edition, and probably more, so that, I don't know, ilan ba panels yung Marla? Two sets. So hopefully, makadagdag tayo in due course. I understand we've already found enough resources for additional two sets. I don't know why it's taking so long, but hopefully we will be able to give you two more sets shortly. But I think we should actually find ways and means to even reproduce it in larger quantities, so that students, which are the target of this exhibition, will have access to this information. It's not just the panels, they also prepared this brochure, which helps provide explanation of the panels. And so aside from the panels, we also do need to reproduce more of this. And I'd like to congratulate the team that was behind it from the very beginning. Earlier, Yesu said it is their generation that forgets. I think Yesu is a little hard on him and you. Because how can you forget something that you did not experience? In fact, Professor Benji, in a column a few months ago, actually highlighted the point that the distance between this generation and martial law is akin to the distance of our generation and World War II. So my generation, our generation, the teachers that are here, did not experience World War II. So how could we recall the events of World War II if we did not experience it? The same is true for these current generation. We cannot expect on them to have a memory of what occurred during the dark days of martial law if they did not have a personal experience of it. Especially because, unlike World War II, or unlike the Philippine Revolution against Spain and the United States, there is no narrative about martial law that has been developed and accepted and propagate. So the challenge for this generation is to have that, what Marlon referred to, collective memory. What is a collective memory? It is a memory as a people, as a nation, that is developed through a series of activities. What do I mean? Punyeta! Basahan ng artikulo 1 ang mga yan. Hindi kayo gagal. We refer to one phrase and we embrace it. We know it. Even though sometimes those who watch the film will ask, bakit buong pelikula? Nakaupo si Mamini. Ganun pa man, meron tayong collective memory ng naganap ng revolusyon laban sa Kastila, laban sa Amerikano. Bagamat marami pang mga bagay na pinagdedebatihan ukol dyan, ni Salva o Bonifacio, nag-recant ba si Rizal bago siya namatay o hindi, mga ganon, lalo na Jesuita pa yata ang kumausap. Ganun rin sa usapin ng World War II, mga storya ng ating mga magulang at mga lolo. At dahil sa ito ay isang naganap sa buong bansa, sa buong mundo, at lahat ay mayroong karanasan. Sa usapin ng martial law, medyo mas masalimuot sapagkat hindi lahat ng tao ay naging biktima tulad na makikita natin dito ng karahasan ng martial law. In fact, maraming ang nagsasabi na ang mga boboto kay Marcos hindi talaga ang mga millennials. Bagkos, ang mga boboto kay Marcos ay yung henerasyon ng mga bata na nasa eskwela nung sila ay mga grade school at high school ng martial law. Sila po yung mayroong magandang pananaw tungkol sa martial law sapagkat yung propaganda machine ng diktadurya ay umabot sa napakaraming tao. At hindi naman lahat ay nakaranas ng aresto, torture, panggagahasa, extrajudicial killing at iba pa. Ngayon, may mga nais ibura yung katotohanan na yan sa atin. Kaya napakahalaga yung gawain ito. Trabaho tulad ng exhibit na ito, dapat ipalaganap. Mga gawain tulad ito ang trabaho ng mga iba-ibang institusyon ng universidad, dapat ipagpatuloy. At alam ko ng Ateneo, malaki na ang naging ambag para dito. A few years ago, you came out with a book, Down from the Hill. Later, Benji edited a book called Sock Them. There is a second book that's coming out, also supported, by the way, by the Friedrich Ebert Institute. These stories need to be collected, researched, and told. But not only in the form of books, but in other popular media. The other project that we are in the middle of right now is actually a program of recognition and reparation. I just want to update all of you here. It does not matter whether we are many or few. What's important is we know what is being done. The Philippine government passed a law 3 years ago providing for a fund of 10 billion pesos to compensate the victims of martial law. And 75,000 individuals came forward with their stories. The process ended last year in terms of intake. Right now, the board that is in charge of reparation and recognition is going through each of these stories in order to determine the amount of compensation that will be paid out. And hopefully by next year, we will be paying out reparation. But the other important thing, aside from reparation, which is of course an important step to accountability, is that we now have 75,000 pieces of evidence. Stories that have not been told. Stories that can further elaborate what is on this panel, so in that video interview of Professor Benjamin. We need to continue to tell the stories, even when there are those who try to mute us from speaking about them. So I want to encourage all of us to continue to press on, regardless of what happens in these elections. We need to continue to make a full accounting of the truth that these panels, your knowledge products, have already begun to undertake. In fact, tomorrow, I will be at the Department of Education. We will be sitting down with the Department of Education tomorrow to talk about how we might improve the curriculum at elementary and secondary level so that the story of martial law would be properly accounted for. We will be meeting with another colleague of yours who is, I think, a product also of the Ateneo system, Undersecretary Mario. Hopefully, over time, we will be able to set things right. But what's important now is we do not give up and we press on. And this contribution by Sian is one of those first steps. It is on its own insufficient, but it is of course an important necessary step. We need to continue to think of ways and means by which we can have a full accounting and a telling of the story. Ultimately, we intend to set up a proper site. There are proposals to set up a museum dedicated to the history of martial law and the struggle of the people for freedom, democracy, and human rights. We have hit sort of like an obstacle in terms of identifying the appropriate site for it. But once we are able to determine that appropriate site, construction for the museum and discussions with a broader community such as yourselves will begin as to what will be the content of that museum. We want to encourage you to participate in a process of thinking about how we might provide for a proper accounting and telling for future generations. So that, Yesu, Luigi, and the others of this generation might be able to say, yes, I have a memory. While I did not experience it itself, I have that memory because we did our part. We did our part in the telling of the story. We did our part in investing in this collective memory. Something that Maris Jokla, the chair of the National Historical Commission, refers to as time binding. Time binding means these are stories that are told from one generation to another so that younger generations might not have to suffer whatever older generations had experienced. All of us, we have probably experienced the burning of a flame. And when we have children, like I have a daughter, I would always tell my daughter, Kiara, do not touch the flame. And thankfully, she sometimes listens to her father and learns from the experience of the older generation. That's the same thing we must impart on the new generation. The principle of time binding and collective memory that we wish upon this generation a better life, a better future, and we do not wish upon you the horrors and atrocities that we had experienced. You are entitled to your own new histories and experiences, but to have the full potential of what is ahead of you, you must learn from what happened in this country as a people. That's why this work is crucial, it's important. And Marlon, we'll be behind you. We're a little slow. We're still a government agency. But hopefully, if not for this period of when people choose, at least as we move forward, we will continue to work together in ensuring that your generation and the succeeding generations might learn from that important period in our history. Yun lamang po. Magandang umaga sa inyo lahat. Mag-uwi.